You suppose there are people around who can still make birch bark canoes?
Well, there are. Even the white people could make them by following the directions given by Tappanadney. He wrote a book on how to build birch bark canoes. Bark had to be got before sometime in the winter. Winter bark was the best for canoe making. You can get bark any time, but summer bark wasn't as good. It tends to sort of blister, and the bark would be coming apart. See, these little layers, thin layers of fiber, whatever you want to call it, in the bark. Bark, you know, has about 25 or 30 thicknesses of little thin stuff, something like cigarette paper. Well, in the winter, that becomes solid, just like a piece of leather. But in the spring, or in the summer, it's good. Birch bark is good right up until the blossoming of the strawberries. It is winter bark. It does not start to separate until after that. So we used to get this bark about April. As soon as the frost got out of the trees.
¶¶
But the older Indians used spruce roots to bind the bark to the gunwale.
What was the reason that they stopped making the canoes? Was it lack of bark or what?
Well, the canvas canoes came in style then. And they were quite cheap too. Because I remember myself when they started selling canvas canoes in town here, you could get a 16-foot canoe for $40. 18 or 20 foot canoe for $65.
And they last longer than
that. Oh, yes, sure. You can paint it, and there was no gumming or anything like that. And some of the Indians going over roots, according to grandfather, they had canoes built when it was too far to carry. Someplace where you had to go maybe 50, 60 miles, they would leave the canoe and make one at the other end. So they didn't have to have no great amount of tools, an axe and a knife, but about all that's needed.
And the know-how.
And the know-how, yes. You could, other tools that you need, well, you could shape them off with your axe and knife. Cedar had to be got, straight grain cedar, for ribs and what they call the planking, which went between the bark and the rib. You see, the bark was laid out, this big sheet, and you would make your gunwale or frame, which would be the shape of the canoe. First, they put weights, rocks, but on these crossbars, or put a stick or two across from one crossbar to another and weighted down good with rocks, with good heavy rocks weighing about 40, 50 pounds, and put enough in them there so the thing wouldn't move around. These two stakes, you drive two of them on each side, and then you take a piece of cedar bark and tie them together so they won't spread out any wider. Well, these stakes are drove all along the length of the whole frame. About every foot would be a set of stakes. You shift your weight on the bark itself. And then you bring this frame up to whatever depth you want your canoe. And then you will start sewing it onto the frame at that depth. In the middle, you start from the middle, then you go along, then you come to where the frame has to be turned up on the ends. And that way you'll get your shape of the canoe. I must mention this, where two men could not build a canoe the same size because they measured everything with their arms and like whatever they could span in their length of, you know, their arms or their fingers. So any canoe made by a man just fitted him. A big man couldn't, well, he could use it, of course, but a big man would naturally have to build a bigger canoe. Not because he had to, but that was his measurement, his body, the length of his arm, like from his elbow to his fist. And that was used at certain places where you measure the size of your canoe.
I read somewhere about measuring sticks being used for something to do with canoe making. They were handed down from generation to generation.
Right. Yeah, well, that's to keep him, so a man won't have to get down and measure his length of what he could reach.
Right.
He'd just make the one measuring stick, and that could be used without having to get down and lay on the bark. Another fellow came along, Nicholas Smith. He was just a young fellow that just came out of the Army, the Second World War. From 1945, he got out of the Army and he entered Columbia University and he took up anthropology. When he graduated, he had to do his thesis and he did some research, and he happened to go to Salem Museum, which was where Tappanadney's manuscripts were kept. So anyway, this fellow, Nicholas Smith, he was going over Tappanadney's work, and he ran across my name, as I was the informant to Tappan, where he mentioned me. So he came here and looked me up. And he was very interested, too, and so he got himself a job over here at Island Falls, which is only about 30 or 40 miles from here. So he could be here with me on weekends. Friday night he'd come here and we'd talk all evening, and he'd spend the night here. Saturday we'd work all day. Saturday night he'd spend another night here and he wouldn't go back to work until Sunday evening. And he did that for about 4 or 5 years. He spent all his weekends here. He'd write about the stories I'd tell him and the Indians' habits and things like that. And he wrote quite a lot of things of the Indian life, like tobacco and dancing and things like that, the Indian culture. For instance, he found 70 or 80 different uses of birch bark where this was not known. They knew that birch bark was useful to Indians, but not that many uses. And I'm sure he has more material than any man that I've ever worked with in pictures and on tapes. When you're sewing the bark together to a point at the end, you start your stitch way back, say about an inch and make this long stick. Next one would be, take the next split of the stem, and your stitches would get more shallow, timing it out the end, and then you start another one like that. And that way, the bark wouldn't split from hole to hole. And then to get the right size of right bend of the right bend of the ribs, you bend them in one inside the other, about four in a group. Them is tied together. You make a little sort of a strap of a cedar bark. You put one in there, and you put the others inside that one to get about four. Then you get the other ones. You know, as they get smaller, you take one for measurement and start another bundle. Four of that inside of each other, and then you go along, they'll just fit about right.